Oh, yeah, look at that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Woo! Oh,
nice one.
Oh, yeah, he's still right, he's still up.
That was pretty crazy.
Nice, huh?
All right. So, your name is John Roberson.
Yep.
And you're the founder of Jaws.
Yeah, well, not the founder. I moved over here in 1970, and I bought some land up here. And we didn't know what was down here because, you know, we just surfed Cape Honolulu Bay and Lahaina and Pakakalo and all the surf spots. Nobody even knew about this until we were down picking opihis, which are little shellfish to sell to the locals. They put them in luaus and stuff like that. They're a delicacy. And we pick them and we sell them for $2 a pound in the shell to Stanley Boscar's dad. So anyways, we ran into old man Malaki, John Malaki. He told us, what are you guys doing? We go, oh, we're picking opihis to get gas money to go surfing. He goes, oh yeah, you gotta come look at this place. And we're going, what? Because it was summertime, all flat, nothing. And he said, no, you look at this place. It's the best way, you gotta look at this. So the next winter when it came big, we drove down and checked it out, and sure enough, this is what we saw, Jaws. But at that time, we called it domes. Because when we discovered it, we called it domes because there's a dome house by the house, by the road. So we called it domes. So we called our friends, Randy Rarick and the Aikaus and everybody that we knew from Oahu to come and surf it, but they kind of didn't believe us. You know, because they're used to surfing Waimea and Sunset and stuff. We're going, no, come check it out. But after 2 years went by, we finally decided, look, we've been watching enough. Nobody's coming over here. So we got it on a nice early day, glassy. And we decided, me and John Lemus and John Potterick and myself, and Mike Clay's lived at the Dome House, and he's the only one with a camera with a lens on it. So he told us, you run get your surfboards and I'll get my camera. When we checked it out, it was about 10 to 12 feet, and we thought we could handle fine, no problem. So we got back, and it started coming up a little bit. So we walked down this hill and paddled out. Well, by the time we got out, it had already jumped to 15 to 20 feet, and the wind came up, and it got giant. We tried to paddle in, but we were riding 7-8 boards and 7-6 boards with no leashes, no wetsuits, no nothing. And we're out there going, fuck, how do we get in? We couldn't catch the waves. Do we paddle to Maliko, or how are we going to get in? So we decided just to wait for a lull and then just charge the shoreline, all the rocks and everything. So I made it in, John Lemus made it in, and John Potterick got hit by a whitewater. Knocked him into the rocks, 6 stitches in the eyes, totally to the hospital. So the photography came out, and it was, by the time it was glassy, the first pictures, but then after that was just bigger and bigger and storming, and one of the shots looked like the mouth of a shark, so we changed it to Jaws.
So was this one of the first times that any?
The first time anybody had ever walked down and paddled out over the rocks.
Wow.
There was no such thing as a jet ski.
For sure.
There was no such thing as a wetsuit with air in it to get you up. We just paddled out without wetsuits or nothing, just right over the rocks, thinking we could handle it because we surfed Big Hokipa, Big Honolulu, everything. So,
what type of boards were you on?
I was on a Brewer, a 710 Dick Brewer surfboard, and they were on 7.6s. You know, we rode big waves at Hokipa. We rode big waves at Honolulu Bay and Pakakalo, so we were into riding 12 to 15 footers. But when we got out there, it had jumped from 12 feet to 15, 18 to 20 feet. Plus, and we couldn't even get in.
Had those easterly winds, right?
Yeah, and the wind came up just crazy, and it was like we made it in with our lives. That's why we changed it from domes to Jaws. And then nobody rode it hardly at all for 4 years after that. Finally, what happened was Laird Hamilton, David Kalama, and Mike Walsh windsurfed up here. From Hokipa, they launched and windsurfed up here, and they were the first ones to ever really catch the wave with the windsurfing boards. That propelled them into it. And then after that, there was a couple stragglers, Matt Kinoshita, a couple guys, Barney, a couple guys paddled in on some 10, 12 foot days so they could barely catch it. So that was basically how it started. And then after Laird started towing in, they thought that you could only tow in. Even movies were made, only can tow in, can't be paddled in. And then my son Kaleo and Nathan Fletcher and a couple of their friends decided, we're gonna paddle in. My dad did it, so we're gonna paddle out. So they paddled through the rocks they started out with 10 foot boards, but they couldn't really catch the waves good. Then they made 11 foot boards and 11 sixes and stuff. Then they started dropping in and catching them. and then the rest is history. They made it to where if, as long as anybody's out there paddling in, you can't tow in.
Yeah.
But then now my grandsons are out there towing in. Baby Steve's paddling in. Baby Steve's already paddled into a 20-footer. 12 years old, he's already towing in and paddling in. Justin and Eric are 14 years old, and today was their first tow-in day.
Changing the game.
Changing the game, but you figure baby's 12 years old. What's going to happen when he's 18?
Yeah.
By the time he's 18, this is just going to be duck soup to him.
Oh, you got guys like Albee having 8-foot boards out here, 8'6", 8'8".
These guys are really good, and they're only going to get better.
Yeah.
So they've changed the game, and they've turned Jaws into one of the national treasures of Maui. And this is a treasure of ours.
And the world, too.
And the world. This is like the best big wave in the world. And these kids are going to dominate. This is going to be their playground, just like it was our playground. But
it's really cool to see all these young kids spending a lot of time
and
out there.
And their dads. You got to get credit. Like Kai Lenny's dad. I give Martin, he's my good friend, credit for training his son, you know, to be a champion. That's what we're doing with our kids. They're going to be champions.
And guys like Kai are great mentors to guys like your grandson.
Oh, yeah, and they all help each other. Yeah. They all watch out for each other out there. Even Kelly Slater watched out for baby Steve at Honolulu and on the North Shore. They surfed the pipeline, Sunset. These kids are as good as they are because of their friends and everybody pitching in and making each other great.
And you gotta love that about the big wave and just the surfing community in general. There's guys.
Oh, yeah, no, it's really a thing because it's not just about the kids. You can't just take, I mean, just like in basketball and stuff, they got their coaches in football. They got their coaches teaching them, and the kids listen, they do good.
Yeah.
And you gotta give the coaches credit.
Yeah.
Especially in life-threatening conditions like these. I mean, these kids learn how to hold their breath. They practice. They have classes in how to hold their breath. So if they get pounded at the bottom, they don't freak out and panic. They, like Nathan Fletcher was telling baby Steve, just be calm. Go into your happy spot, be calm. You're going to come up. You pull the straps, you're going to come up. You got air in there. We didn't have air when we paddled out. We didn't have wetsuit. We didn't even have leashes back in those days.
You lose your board, you got to swim to the beach.
We had one-fin boards. We didn't have thrusters.
Yeah.
Yeah. But we were good swimmers back in those days.
Yeah.
So we always used to beat our boards.
Probably had to learn to swim better back then than they have to now.
Oh, no, that's all we did was swim. When we lost our board, we swim. You know, I've broken boards in half and come up with a half a board and not even let go back in my day. You know, came up with a half a board. The other half of the board's floating on the inside. I didn't even let go. We'd have fingerprints in our boards because we'd roll the wave and hold on for dear life. We didn't want to have to swim in. All right.
Yeah.
All right, on Tucker.
Yeah. What was the last time you surfed Jaws, by the way?
Oh, that was in 1974.
1974.
Yeah.
That was the last time.
Fuck, the once and only.
You think
I'd want to do that again? I was smart enough to, because nobody surfed it for, you know.
So you went out, kept it kind of a secret for.
No, we tried to get guys to paddle out. Nobody was stupid. You know, until Laird, the first guys that really surfed Jaws was when they windsurfed it.
Yeah.
Because then they had the power to catch the wave.
Layered in the strap.
You can't catch this wave hardly unless you really can catch it dead late. And that's only because they started doing it with a little bit larger boards. So they could catch, you got to catch it before you ride it.
Exactly.
You know? And well, so,
yeah.
And then now the really good guys have transitioned into smaller boards.
It's amazing to see.
Oh, it's really.
The last 50 years on how it's changed.
I would say the last 8 or 9 years have really been an education for everybody.
Well, Shane Dorian and Ian Walsh came out here with big guns when everyone was towing all those
big
kids.
Big guns.
Yeah.
They weren't riding regular guns. They were riding special boards shaped for Jaws.
Yes.
And that's why Makua Rothman, all these guys, Billy Kemper.
Shit,
these guys are amazing what they're doing nowadays, you know? And all these, I remember when little Billy was just little, and Eric, his brother, was a champion with my son, Justin. Justin Roberson and Eric and all the legends that are gone now, they'd be proud. They're watching from above.
For sure. Well, thanks for your time, John. I really appreciate it.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. Woo-hoo-hoo! Come on, babe.
Oh!
By the skin of his teeth. Oh, my God.
Man
down.
Shit. And with no fucking floating. Okay, and now that you've heard the history of Jaws and surfing, how would you like to have the history of Hawaii and the first people that came here from Hawaii? They came from Tahiti, Hawaii, wherever they said that was, and the first people left over a religious persecution they decided rather than being controlled by the chiefs of Hawaiki, they went to find their own land. They were promised that if they went in search of a new land, that they would find it. So they followed the stars to the Pleiades, or the Seven Sisters constellation. Well, they landed at La Perouse. They came and they landed on Maui. They didn't land on Oahu. The first Hawaiians, the first people, landed at La Perouse. Okay, look at La Perouse. It's like a desert.
Yeah.
You think they settled at La Perouse? No. They looked for the perfect places to where they could fish, where they could grow their taro, they could grow their land. Shoot this valley over here. This is the Valley of Jaws. It's called Kapakalua. And so this is one, there's big heiaus up here in the valley. Where as the populations grew, the populations of the Hawaiians grew, and they moved to Wailuku, they moved all around, some of them went to Oahu. And then out at the point, Kahakili was the last reigning king of the Hawaiian Islands, out at the point from Wailuku, way out at the point. And he ruled the Hawaiian Islands. And Kamehameha came and landed about 5 miles at Halehaku Bay and waged the war against Kahakili to take over the Hawaiian Islands. And he landed here and they marched just past Jaws, armies going up there, and they fought the war and took over the Hawaiian Islands. But this is where they landed, and this is where the first Hawaiians settled here. So that's what another special thing about Jaws and all the land around Jaws and everything. It's probably one of the first 7 or 8 civilizations. You got Hana, so they probably settled in Hana. They probably had some nice sandy beaches in Kaanapali and stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, who knows where they really settled? Lahaina, cherry places, fishing areas. They had their canoes and stuff. They knew what they were doing. But I'm just saying, we've got evidence of the heiaus and stuff that these were some of the first civilizations in all of Hawaii, right around in here.
There's a lot of spiritual...
Yeah, a lot of spiritual things in these areas. But here, you got fresh water coming in. There's taro paddies going all the way up, you know. And I'm just saying, places that they settled in Hawaii, and this is Maui, is where they landed and started the whole civilization of the Hawaiian Islands. Of course, you know, they spread all out, you know, Kauai, Big Island, Molokai. I mean, you know, it's a trip. I don't know all the history, but I know some of it, and this is where it all started.
Right here in Maui.
Right here on Maui.
Yeah.
Like I say, this is one of the first civilizations in this area of all of Hawaii.
Wow.
And so that's another thing we can be grateful for.
Yeah, for sure.
Cool.
Well, thank you, John.
Okay.
Yeah.